Hello, welcome to this short service for the 1st of November 2020, which is All Saints Day. The clocks went back last week and the evenings are dark. I know that some people find this time of year really difficult anyway, and the current crisis only makes things worse. If you're feeling lonely or sad, we do want to be here for you, so please do make contact. On this Sunday, we think about the extraordinary claim that we are all saints. Not paragons of virtue, but examples of salvation. If God can make us part of the kingdom, then no one is beyond the pale. We are part of a community of forgiven sinners in which the world's divisions by class or race or gender don't count for anything. We are brothers and sisters. We are all saints. So let's begin with prayer. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Grant us grace so to follow that your blessed saints, in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those inexpressible joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The reading is from 1 John chapter 3. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope purify themselves, just as he is pure. Do you look like your parents? I'm always amazed when people look into a cot and say, "Ooh, he looks just like his dad." I suppose if dad is bald with a little stubby nose and a double chin, you could see the sense. But actually, babies rarely look like their parents. It's as they grow older and the features begin to form that you can see the father's eyes, the mother's cheekbones. They are growing into the image of their parents. Some people say that owners look like their dogs. And as everyone's reaction to Freya at the moment is, "Oh, isn't she gorgeous?" I'm rather hoping that might be true. Do you behave like your parents? As you've got older, have you caught yourself complaining about young people's music and thought, "I'm turning into my mother"? Have you found that the values instilled in you by your parents are the ones you in turn want to instill in your own children? Do you find that even if your parents have died, you still want to do things which would make them proud? It's quite a sobering thought that even if our children don't look like us, people will assume that for good or ill, their values will be our values. And if they do something wrong, they will blame us. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are God's children. And what we will be has not yet been made known. You may or may not be pleased to be the child of your parents. You may not appreciate the knobbly knees you inherited from your mother or the premature baldness you got from your father. And your parents may not have set the best of examples, and you may have had to spend some of your adult life unlearning the lessons of your youth. Suppose for a moment, though, that you were the child of a person everyone knows and loves. Suppose that for people to say, "Oh, you are so-and-so's girl," or "so-and-so's boy," was a huge honour. Imagine people telling you that they knew your mother and she was a great woman. That would be a source of great pride and identity. And that is where John starts this part of his letter. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. We carry the family name. We are the adopted children of the royal household. We are the sons and daughters of Almighty God. We are part of God's family. Now, of course, for this to mean anything to anyone else would involve them knowing God for themselves and therefore being able to recognise God's image in us. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. In his gospel, John records Jesus saying something very similar. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. So there is a sense in which this is our secret. We can't expect the world to recognise us because it doesn't yet know our Father. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. I was looking at my hands the other day and thinking, I've got my father's hands. My dad was good at woodwork and I used to admire his hands. And now I seem to have inherited them. I don't think they used to be like that. But then I didn't know him when he was young. Little by little, we believe, like a seed growing in secret, or like yeast working in a lump of dough, God's Spirit is at work in us, transforming us into God's image, little by imperceptible little. On the outside, we may be getting older and uglier, but inside, we are being changed. As St. Paul beautifully put it, therefore we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So one day, like the seedling emerging from the ground or the butterfly from the chrysalis, what we truly are, what has been going on all the time, unrecognised and unseen, will become fully apparent for us and the world to see. All those who have this hope purify themselves as he is pure. Although we can't really hope to emulate our Heavenly Father, if we are proud to be God's children, we will want to make God proud by behaving, so far as we can, in ways that we know would make him glad. That is the basis of Christian living. It's probably the same reason you find you're living by the values you've inherited from your earthly parents. We believe that we are God's children, and so we try to behave as God's children, because we want to make our Father proud of us. Then the tone of the letter changes, and John explores one of the recurrent themes of the letter, the relationship between being in Christ and living a righteous life. He says, everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. I've lost count of the number of films I've watched which feature a future world where law and order have broken down and everyone just takes what they want. Mad Max made Mel Gibson famous. It imagined a post-apocalyptic world in which there was no law, no justice, except for one man. It sparked a whole heap of films with the same basic idea, the Wild West set in the future. And they invite us to imagine a world without law, without justice, where everyone does what they want, what they can get away with, and takes what they want. And John paints a contrast between light and darkness, and between law and lawlessness. Sin, he says, puts us on a road to chaos. Doing what you want, denying you are your father's child, leads you to a world of bondage and destruction. And into this world, Jesus brings law, order, and freedom. And that's why all the heroes of those films, from Mel Gibson to Clint Eastwood, have been Christ figures in their own distorted, imperfect way. Jesus was revealed to take away sin, says John. Here is the hero striding onto the stage to bring order out of chaos. And we have a choice. Do we want to live in the light or in the darkness? In the town or in the hills? Are we on the side of justice or of chaos? Because we can't choose both. John's letter can be quite confusing about this, because on the one hand he says that God in Jesus makes provision for our sin. And on the other he says that no one who sins has seen him or known him, which I guess would rule us all out. But he's not writing a piece of doctrine, he's exploring a conviction. Just as light and darkness are opposites, just as law and lawlessness are opposites, so abiding in sin and abiding in Christ are opposites. There's no compromise, no negotiation, no point at which a little bit becomes okay. The nearer you come to God, the further you get from sin, because the one cannot abide the other. If you want to be your Father's child, you have to be transformed into your Father's image. In God, there is no good enough. I suppose if I had to sum up the meaning of this passage for us all these hundreds of years later, I would say, become what you are. Be encouraged that you are already the child of your Heavenly Father. You already bear his image, and already, unseen and unnoticed, the Spirit is at work in you, transforming you into his image. And one day, in a world as yet unimaginable, what you truly are will be fully revealed. Even as each year goes by, your body is less able to do what it once could. Inwardly, you are being changed into God's likeness. And meanwhile, live in such a way as to make your Father proud. In the light, not the darkness. According to God's law, not according to lawlessness. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been made known. Be proud that you bear your Heavenly Father's likeness, not his eyes or his chin, but his heart. God has adopted you into the family and given you the family name. And you can walk tall in that knowledge, even if others don't recognise it. Each day, if we allow it, God works his purpose in us. And one day, for all the frustrations of this life, his will be done. Amen. So I suppose by far the most famous hymn for this Sunday is For All the Saints. There are an awful lot of verses to this hymn, but here are just a few of them, sung at a Remembrance Sunday service in Ireland.
Thank you.
So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you that you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. As we spend time with you, so we are transformed into your likeness from one degree of glory to another. Help us to reflect this truth in our lives and in our churches. May your kingdom on earth reflect your kingdom in heaven, where there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for we are all one in Christ Jesus. May we be people through whom the light of your love and your mercy shine. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray for people we know who are struggling at this time. We pray for those on whom the weight of this pandemic falls most heavily. For those separated from loved ones and friends. For those who are afraid. For those who are struggling to pay the bills. We pray for children, especially those who are hungry or missing out on their education. We pray that as a society we may rise to the challenge of building a better, fairer world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord look kindly on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.